chilly morning. Just be aware of deacons and building grounds that our pipes are in different freezing right now, and so we're going to be vigilant around here to make sure that we don't have a catastrophe. So you know, just all hands on deck here and watch that. You go a prayer request if Miss Kent. Nasika's uncle, Patsy's sister, Bobby Dean Phillips, is in the process of dying right now. He's in Nasika and Joey's apartment for a few days, and then they're going to move him from there into the final stage for hospice. Just pray for them. It's unbelievable. I saw him right before I left for vacation, went to his house and visited with him, and we talked for an hour. And to see the difference in 2 weeks is unbelievable. He's got cancer, his brain's everywhere, so. But we're talking to him. I talked to him yesterday. The seekers talked to him about the Lord, and we're hopeful that like the thief on the cross, he's coming to Jesus. And you pray, and we're talking to him. Okay. I know y'all remember that the last time I preached. Was that this year? That was last year. I told y'all when we finished up going through verses 1 through 5 of Romans 5, which is where we are today, that verse 5 probably needed more attention. And so I thought about it while I was gone. And I'm convinced it needs more attention. So we're going to be today. I'm going to read verses 1 through 5, and then we're going to look at verse 5. It needs so much more attention. We'll look at it next week. So be prepared. Now, what I want to do, I want to read these verses just to, I realize when we have a few weeks of break in between verses that we kind of sometimes we lose our context. So I'm just going to just read through and comment on these five verses, okay? In chapter 5, verse 1, Paul begins with, "Therefore, since we have been," past tense, "justified by faith," we've been declared righteous by God. If God declares you righteous and considers you righteous, you're righteous to him. Does it mean we're even righteous to ourselves? Sometimes we know we fall into sin, but we are justified by faith. And because of that, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That means everything has been removed that would cause us to be at war or in enmity or him to be at war against us. It's gone. We are at peace. Verse 2 says, "Through him, Christ, we have obtained access by faith into this grace, this undeserved favor." We know we don't deserve it, but we've got it anyway. "In which we stand, and because we know all these things, we rejoice in hope of the glory of God." It's a certainty for us. Everything we read about in Scripture, about the glory of God, the little glimpses we get of what it might be like around the throne and all the glory. We're bound for glory, saints. We are bound for that glory. More than that, verse 3, "We rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering does stuff." Besides hurt. Hey, that's important to know. "More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance or perseverance." Listen, when we go through our times of hurt and turmoil and illness and all sorts of stuff, and we hold on to Jesus, and we fight our way through to victory, when we get through it, it tells us, We really are in the faith. We don't quit. We don't cop out. It's ever- we're still standing. Through it all, we're still standing. Verse 4, and endurance produces character. It means proven character. What were you just talking about? Hey, I am for real. Endurance produces proven character, and character produces more hope. Now we know even more by experience that we're going to experience the glory of God. Verse 5. This is where we stopped last time. And hope does not put us to shame. This hope we have, we'll never be embarrassed that we had it, because we're going to get everything God has told us we're going to get. It certainly means when we get to the judgment, the hope that we have will not be put to shame. We are justified by faith. I hope you understand. You're justified, you're declared righteous by faith. That's something God does. He justified you. That's the way He looks at you. You can't do anything to mess up what God does. We can mess up everything else, but we can't mess that up. We can't mess up what God does. And that's what He says is true of you, believer. Okay, let me read just all of verse 5 and then we'll take it apart. And hope does not put us to shame, because He's just to give us some more reasoning for that. Because hope doesn't put us to shame because something's happened to us to reinforce that. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Now listen, before we're kind of deducing things, this is true of me, so. This is true of me, so. This is true of me, so I receive this. But what He transitions into here is not positional things. We're not deducing something. We are having experiences in ourselves produced by God putting His Spirit in us. So it's the title of our message today. The Spirit in us. When we think about God, we think about the Trinity. The hardest part of the Trinity for us to get a handle on is the Holy Spirit. Think about this. What do you think about when you think about God the Father? Not too hard, is it? God the Father. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We probably have our best understanding within ourselves of God the Son, because He came down here and lived with us, and walked with us, and talked to us, made promises to us. We look for Him to come back again for us. But the Holy Spirit is more troubling. He's called the Holy Spirit. You'll see in some of our scriptures today. He's called the Spirit of God. He's called the Spirit of Christ. Listen, that's not three different spirits. There is just one Spirit. Now, some people want to view the Spirit as kind of an it. It is the presence of God the Father. It is the presence of God the Son. But the New Testament will not let us believe that, because it treats the Holy Spirit as a person. He has feelings. So the Bible says, don't grieve the Spirit. He's not an it. He's a person. He's a personality. So we believe in the Trinity, in the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now, people that do not believe in the Trinity. I went to a church one time in Fort Worth with a cousin of mine, and the church just believed in a duality. They believed in God the Father and God the Son, and they just believed that the Holy Spirit was just Him again, not separate. You have been in Pentecostalism. There's a big branch of Pentecostalism. United Pentecostals is probably the biggest one of them. They are Unitarians. They are oneness. They don't believe even in two. They believe that there's just one person in the Godhead. And so, Unitarianism is considered heresy by the church as a whole. But then the other part about the Holy Spirit is how some people make the Holy Spirit more important than anything else. And church is all about the Holy Ghost and the gifts of the Holy Ghost and the expressions of the Holy Ghost. It's odd that you could make the Holy Ghost everything when Jesus said, when the Spirit comes, He will not speak of Himself. He will speak of me and mine. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is not the Holy Spirit. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is to make Jesus known. So don't get out of whack here with this. When you deal with things like this, I know some of y'all just yawn. Listen, these things will never make sense until you get a sense of the big picture of what God is doing. Where does it fit? You get the big picture of what God is doing from before creation and choosing to save people. He comes and we have the consummation. Whatever we think and think we believe, it has to fit in this plan. If it sticks out like a sore thumb, then we're trying to bring something into God's plan that is not really of God. Not necessarily an evil thing, but it's just not, it's not a real thing. And we shouldn't be wasting our time on things that aren't real. Trying to have things happen to us that it's not for us to have. Now, part of the problem with this is going to the day of Pentecost and seeing what happens there, and then trying to model your whole church life off of that day without any understanding of why did that day happen? Why did the day of Pentecost happen the way that it happened? Now listen, there are a lot of people who think being saved is not enough. After you're saved, you've got to seek and tarry like the people that were doing at Pentecost until you get a baptism of the Holy Spirit or a filling with the Holy Spirit that's way more than just being saved. And listen, almost all, just go back and take, it almost all has to do with the fact that there was a day of Pentecost. Well, why was there a Pentecost? We'll get there. Now, here's what Paul says in verse 5. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Paul's assumption is always that every believer has the Holy Spirit. If I have the Holy Spirit, why do I need to seek for Him more? Well, they're saying there's this other whole separate experience you're supposed to get. And there is not. Paul in chapter 8, 5, verse 9 says this real clearly. He says, you, however, are not in the flesh, But in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now listen to what he says here. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. If you don't have the Spirit, you're not saved. Period. If you do have the Spirit, you have the whole, you have the only Holy Spirit that there is. Okay? Now listen. It doesn't mean that we can't experience Him in greater ways. The same people who were filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, you just follow them about five chapters over, or four to chapter five, and guess what? They all get filled with Spirit again. Now, so we can be filled and filled and filled and filled and refilled with the Holy Spirit. Confess our sin and claim the Spirit. But that's not us getting something totally different than what we got when we were saved. It's just experiencing those blessings more and more and more in the fullness of the Spirit. That's the normal Christian life. Now, why did Pentecost happen? Listen, here's the reasoning for why you're supposed to have other experiences. The disciples walked with Jesus, right? They were saved, right? But then, though saved, they tarried to receive the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. If that's true of Peter, surely it's true of us. But Peter didn't have what you have now before Pentecost. He had Jesus. Okay? And I want you to think, how many times did Jesus say, I have to go, so that when I go, I'm going to send you something better. I'm going to send you another comforter who will be with you always. Pentecost is about an ascension gift. It is a gift given by Christ after he has ascended to heaven in his glorified body and he sits at the right hand of the throne. He sends this. Let me just prove that to you by scripture. John's Gospel, chapter 7. Jesus says, on the last day of the feast, the great feast, Jesus stood up and cried out, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the Scripture has said, out of his heart, King James, out of his belly, out of his inmost being, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. That sounds like an experience. Now, this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For as yet the Spirit had not been given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Is that simple? Anybody have any questions about what that means? The hang-ups you see there? He just says, you can't have this experience until I'm gone. Because the Holy Spirit, in a sense, is his replacement. Because, think about this. I wish I could live when Jesus walked on the earth. Think about this. How many people could actually get around Jesus while he was on the earth? I mean, well, he fed the 5,000. That's 5,000. Well, what about the billions of us? The Holy Spirit can be with a billion people. If they ever exist, the trillion people, because he can be with all of us. I just want you to see that Jesus really talks about this a lot. Chapter 14. In 15, he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Then in 16, following, he says this, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, comforter, to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth. Is
that the Holy Spirit?
That's the Spirit of God? That's the Spirit of Christ? Same Spirit?
Yes.
Right. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you. That's the way it is while Jesus is on earth. For is the Spirit with us and will be in you. Difference than with and in. Now he's in us. He's in 18 says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. He comes to us in the Holy Spirit. Okay. For the real hard of head and heart, one more. Chapter 16, verse 7. Here it is. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Look, here's what happens. Jesus is crucified, goes in the tomb, raised on the third day, stays around for 40 days. He just comes and goes. He appears to a lot of people. Paul says it to as many as 500 at one time, but for 40 days. And then he ascends physically. Bodily, physically, he just ascends, goes out of sight, back in the Father. What are the disciples told to do? Go in Jerusalem and wait. So they go there and they wait. They take care of some business like replacing Judas, who had fallen out of the 12, and they replaced him by one who had been with him from the beginning and had witnessed Jesus and all these things. But they wait for 10 days. On that 10th day, the day of Pentecost, and a big, huge feast day for Israel. Acts says there's people there from every nation under heaven, because the Jews have been scattered and rescattered, and they're everywhere up there. They come back to this feast day. And on that day, they're waiting, and you hear the sound of a rushing, mighty wind. And it is the gift that Jesus promised all along. He was going to send. It fills the house, and all these miraculous things happen, and that's Pentecost. Now, he could be with us, but now he's in us. Now, every person who comes to Christ, every born-again person, you have a spirit. You don't need a separate experience. Now, I just say this to y'all. I've had people through 40 years of ministry come to me, well, now listen, my sister just says, we don't have it all. I'm telling you, I want you to understand, you have it all. I don't care what they say. You have it all. Now listen, we can experience it in greater waves of glory. I'm not saying that it's never good for us to lay things aside and to seek God and to spend times of reflection in the Word and seek to cleanse our lives of all things that would be displeasing to God and ask God to turn His searchlight on us and search us and see if there be any wickedness in you that I can renounce it, because I don't want anything between me and God. I don't want to spoil the fellowship that we have with Him that is experiential. So, now, I want to show you that Paul views even the most carnal or fleshly Christians weak and falling and stumbling. They still have the Holy Spirit if Deborah knows. I spent a lot of my life around people who thought, as soon as you sin, Holy Ghost leaves. He's checked out. He's taken the bus to the coast. Paul says, doesn't leave. Which is why you ought to watch where you go. You think about when you take the Holy Spirit in you. 1 Corinthians, he's writing to a church. He's writing to a church that has sexual sin taking place by members of the church. Is that possible? It's possible, isn't it? Now, listen. Are all these people who participate in these sins, is it because none of them were really saved? Or is it possible for believers to yield to temptation and fall into sin? Just listen to how Paul talks about this. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm going to begin at verse 15. He's been talking about how we are not under law. It doesn't mean that there's not things that are bad for us and bad to do. He says in verse 15, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? We're part of the body of Christ, aren't we? What that means? I mean, that is mystical union. We have been joined to Christ. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Why are things like that in the Bible? Because it was a big problem in Paul's day. You know what they had in Corinth, in Ephesus? They had idol gods. They had temples to those idol gods, and they worshipped them by going into temple prostitutes. Prostitution was everywhere, male and female. And now Paul's coming along. He's planting churches in the shadow of some of those places. This is not the first generation that's had to face great temptation. It's in our face. We think, it's never been this bad before. Well, we didn't have some of the stuff, you know, but I'm telling you, every generation faces this and you have to deal with it. But this one, just said, shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Is it possible? Paul says it is. Because you're still part of the body of Christ. Paul says, never, God forbid, don't do it. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? And here, he's going back to Genesis. Man, his father and mother leaves his wife, they become one flesh. You're going to apply that to prostitution? For it is written, the two will become one flesh. But listen. But he who is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Flee from sexual immorality. Don't just back up. He's saying, run. Just run. Don't think. Don't analyze. Just run. Listen. Satan works, plots, sets up ambushes. Flee from sexual immorality.
Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the sexual immoral person sins against his own body. The harm's coming back on the person. Verse 19. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you? Now listen, he's writing to these people as giving correction and telling these people that are involved in sexual sin, don't you know that the Holy Spirit's within you? And he's in you when you practice this sin? Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Listen, the Holy Spirit in us is in us for the whole long time. We're believers, we will come out of that. That's the deal. Does John say they went out from us to make evident that they never really were of us? That could be the case. But Paul's not assuming that here. He's assuming he's dealing with believers in the church who are falling into sin. That's what he means. Listen, saints. We let our guards down. We could be pulled into about any sin that any sinner can be. It's possible. Y'all remember me telling y'all one time, some of you, I don't know if it's Wednesday or Sunday, I told you about meeting this guy one time. I was at kind of a men's get together, many business guys, most of them Christian. And then this guy come in as a kind of a motivational guy, I'm somewhere outside of Dallas. I'm in the country. I can't remember. Were you with me when I saw the guy in the grove? The women were somewhere else doing something else. But we had this guy, and he was there because he had set, he was in the, at that time, this was about 20 years ago, he had set the Guinness Book of World Records for making the most free throws in the free throw line. He was a machine. We set up a goal, marked off a line, and we just sit up there, and he's shooting free throws and talking, and we're asking questions, and he's shooting free throws. He never missed. Do you remember how he got so good? He got so good in prison. He had time on his hands. Had access to a basketball. I don't know where it was at. But this guy was a Christian. He was a deacon at First, some of y'all remember this, he was a deacon at First Baptist Dallas. He got involved with some other high rollers, putting together a money deal, and they were making a movie, and he had some Dallas Cowboys involved, and so he really thought he had two tall Jones, and if y'all don't know who these guys are, shame on you. Two tall Jones, he was 6'9" and he was on the line. But listen, he had some of these guys that really had some name recognition. So they were borrowing money and this guy really gets extended. Now listen, this is a deacon, and several of these other guys are deacons at First Baptist Dallas. And in the midst of this, but he just almost got it all put together, somehow he gets in a money crunch. And if he can't fix it, it's the whole thing is going to unravel. So he gets desperate. Now listen, this is what Satan does for us. He works to get us desperate, or you lose your mind. So here this guy is, he's getting desperate now, and he does an awful, foolish thing. He takes out a loan on some property that he has already taken a loan out somewhere else. Y'all understand why you can't do that? You can't borrow money property that somebody else already has a note on, and they haven't been paid. So, well, he was probably this close to getting through to paying all that. But one or two of the other deacons realized what he'd done, and they raised the red flag and exposed him. And here's this guy, a deacon at First Baptist Church, involved with some other deacons, trying to put together a movie deal. Went to prison. Understand something. By his own testimony, he was a Christian when he went to prison. He was a Christian when he came out of prison. And basically, he was telling his story. It can happen to you. So, if you're a believer, this guy had the Holy Spirit, did a dumb thing with the Holy Spirit, and went to prison. The Holy Spirit's in prison with him. Came out to get to share his testimony. Holy Spirit's still with him. So, if we're believers, we have the Holy Spirit. What Paul is leading us into here is the fact that we have the Holy Spirit in us should enter our minds before we enter some doors. Where we go, what we do, we are not our own. We have been bought with a price. We are to remember that. Okay. Now, here's the next thing he says here in chapter 5, or in verse 5. He says, the Holy Spirit does something in us. He says, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Now remember this. He's been saying that we are rejoicing in hope of the glory of God because we know all that we're justified by faith, which is not an experience. We just know it's true. So we rejoice because we know it's true. But now he's saying in chapter 5, and hope does not put us to shame because, and he goes off into something that's not position, it's experience. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. King James says, shed abroad. It means it's not coming in drip, drip, drip. No, it's coming like a flood. We've been love bombed by the Holy Spirit in us, releasing in us the love of God to us. Why do we love God? He loved us first. He demonstrates it in us. It's an experience. Do you know by experience that God loves you? Isn't that glorious? That's glorious. I don't have to be a theologian and deduce that. That is direct action from God. Holy Spirit in us releases love. That comes from God, and we experience that in our lives. Hey, if you're a believer, you should know the love of God by experience. Listen to how Paul talks about how God works in us. We'll talk about this a lot. He says in Romans 8:14, he says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. Verse 15, for you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons. I'm going to come back to that. I hope you realize that
believer, you have been adopted into the family of God. You are very privileged. You have incredible privileges that come to you because you're not just a saved individual. You are an adopted individual by God into His family, and Jesus is your elder brother. By whom we cry, Abba Father. I like that. Term of endearment. Now listen, the Spirit Himself, not itself, the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. That's experiencing. It's the Spirit in us bearing witness, and so we know by experience this is true. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with Him in order that we may also be glorified with Him. Then he says, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Bound for glory. Bound for glory. Here's just one last thing. I want to try to put all this in a big picture for you. But the Bible says this about having the Holy Spirit in us. And that is that the Holy Spirit in us is evidence that we will be glorified. And we talk about this sometimes about in other ways. We can say, if you've been born again, you're going to be glorified. That's true. But Paul talks about this in a way that says, if you have the Holy Spirit at work in your life, and you know it, that same Holy Spirit is going to glorify you. So when we're conscious of the Holy Spirit, it is evidence that we are bound for glorification. This is how he says it in Romans 8:10. He says, but if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Now listen, verse 11. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you now. That's where the glorification comes from. It's the Holy Spirit you have in now. Okay, let me give you the big picture of what the Holy Spirit is all about. Best place is Ephesians 1, where you get work of the Father, work of the Son, work of the Holy Spirit. We talk a whole lot more about work of the Father, work of the Son, than we usually do work of the Holy Spirit. But listen, but that's how you fit the big picture together. Bookend to bookend, and what goes in between. This is the whole plan of God for us and how it works. Okay? Starts out with, in verse 3 and 4, the work of the Father. It's kind of like John 3:16, where it starts with, God so loved the world. This is where Paul starts here. This is about God the Father. Blessed, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, you got the Father, God the Son, but blessed be God, who has blessed us in Christ. God the Father, God the Son are working together before creation and
planted to save lost people. That's why we're here today. In Christ, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy. That we should be is one word in the Greek. It's an infinitive, kind of a verbal noun. It's an infinitive of purpose. Why is God doing all this? To make us holy. That's the whole end game here, is that we be holy and blameless before Him. Now listen. In love, He predestined us, for adoption as sons. God always intended that we'd be more than just creatures or saved creatures. He predestined us for adoption as sons. Does that tie in everything else the Bible says about who we are? Through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will. Now, the Father chooses us on the basis of what the Son will do. What did the Son do? Verse 7 says, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. That's what the Son does. He comes, born in Bethlehem, robed in flesh, lives here, ministers here, proves who He is here, sinless, dies on the cross, resurrected, ascended in glory. He saves us by His blood. Okay? That's God the Father. That's God the Son. What does God the Holy Spirit do? Whatever it is that God the Holy Spirit does, that's what He's really all about. Not whatever we think about some experience or something. It's His. Verse 13 goes to the Holy Spirit. In Him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, were sealed with the promise, Holy Spirit. What does that mean? In Him also, when you heard the word, the gospel has to be preached, doesn't it? When you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in Him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. Does that mean you've been sealed like a ketchup bottle? So you can't leave? No. It means you've been sealed with God's seal of ownership and you belong to Him. You're sealed. Now, verse 14, this is what it's about. Who is the guarantee? Who? The Holy Spirit. The seal. Who is the guarantee? Or the earnest money, the down payment guarantee, the whole, right? Who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory? That's what He does. Listen, it's the Holy Spirit that does everything to bring those chosen by the Father, redeemed by the Son. It's the Holy Spirit that does all the work of bringing us to life, of giving us understanding of the gospel, so we exercise faith in Christ. That's all Him. That's what He's here for. He's really busy with the big important stuff. And it's not about what kind of an experience we get. His work is the Son. His work is the Holy Spirit. His work. And He seals us until the end of it. He seals us until glory comes. We belong to Him. Here's a test. You have to answer out loud. How many angels gave him name?
Who are they?
Michael.
Gabriel.
Gabriel.
Gabriel. Huh? Fallen angel. What do you think about him? Who else? Come on. Huh? Angel of the Lord? Is that probably Jesus? That's okay, it's true. It's true, it's biblical. You have a name, Michael. Okay. Angel Clarence? Come on now. I knew you didn't read the Bible. I thought you'd at least watch movies. Angel Clarence? Now come on now. Now you know this door's open. Who else?
John Travolta.
Was he a fallen angel? I was thinking of the angel Dudley. Did you see the preacher's wife? The angel Dudley. Now let's just zero in on the angel Clarence. My personal favorite. And the angel Dudley. Listen, did y'all know that the preacher's wife was a remake of a movie made back in the, I don't know, 30s or 40s, that were Cary Grant with the angel Dudley? Oh, what a good movie. Dudley, he was. Now, that the best we have to hope for as believers is that we get to become angels. Who don't even get our wings on time. We have to wait to get our wings, and that is in any way an idea how this world should be thinking about heaven and who we are. We are not angels. We are so far above angels that we are becoming the younger adopted siblings of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are the children of God. That's who we are, and that's the glory we're bound for. Who wants to be Clarence?
Amen.
He was a sweetheart. That, listen, this is what God has for us who are in Christ. Don't let anybody say that's not the case. It is the case. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your blessed word. We thank you that you have blessed us so with your Holy Spirit given to us, abiding in us, not just with us. We marvel when see how all this unfolded from eternity past and it goes to eternity future, and somehow we've always been in your mind and in your plan. It's amazing. Father, I pray that this is real and understandable to every person here today, but for those who it is not, I pray that you would make it so. That they'd know you and experience you in their life. That they'd trust in you by faith and know that they are forgiven and bound for glory. We pray that